Dr. Everett Piper is the president of the Wesleyan University, Oklahoma Wesleyan University. He advocates for cultural change from a Christian worldview. And a Christian worldview and a perspective is something that we are dramatically starting to miss in our society, but we need to continue to advocate for. Dr. Piper regularly speaks on radio, writes for a number of publications. He is passionate about providing students with best opportunities to impact culture, think independently, and build a biblical foundation for their beliefs. Anybody ever heard of the concept that we need to give an account for what we believe, right? The other side is he has just written a book not too long ago, and I should have that title in front of me. I could almost memorize it, but I'm going to not do it justice if I chop the title, and I know that. But I'm going to ask, Dr. Piper, can you remind me of the title again?
Why I'm a liberal and other conservative ideas.
Why I'm a liberal and other conservative ideas. And that's, I know that's politically incorrect, but y'all work with me. But why I am a liberal and other conservative ideas, and I've actually delved into it a bit, and it is a fascinating book. I think it's a good read, and there should be some copies here afterwards, and he would love to, if you guys pick up some, you could sign them. But let's welcome Dr. Everett Piper.
It's my pleasure to join you. And I want to really thank you, Star, for putting me on after the senator. Thanks a bunch. I appreciate that. After lunch and after the senator. Okay. Yes, I am the guy that wrote the article, "This Is Not a Daycare." I'm also the guy that is suing the federal government, and I've said no to the Obamacare abortifacient mandate.
Amen.
I'm also the college president who has told the Department of Education and the Office of Civil Rights that I will not comply with their transgender requirements and take away a woman's right to her own bathroom.
Come on, Doc. Come on, Doc.
I'm also the guy that went on the O'Reilly Factor during the Indiana RFRA debate, and I told Bill O'Reilly that the LGBTQ protests for tolerance were nonsense and frankly an insult to human dignity.
Come on.
I said that I said to Bill O'Reilly, tolerance is an inferior ethic where love is always superior. I said, tolerance says I could care less. Love says I care a great deal, Mr. O'Reilly. And then I went in and I asked him a question. Mr. O'Reilly, on your anniversary, did you send your wife an I tolerate you card? I suggested that if you did, it probably did not end well. Tolerance says I could care less, do what you want. Love says I care deeply, please stop. Love always inspires, and tolerance always insults. I'm the guy who wrote the Not a Daycare piece back in November that went viral and was cited by NBC Today as one of the top 10 stories of the year. If you don't know the story, let me share it with you as the context for some of the things that I'd like to talk about today. At Oklahoma Wesleyan, we still have required chapel on Wednesday and Friday. We are an unapologetic Christian university. We believe in four things: the primacy of Jesus Christ, the priority of Scripture, the pursuit of truth, and the practice of wisdom. We believe that Jesus is the Son of God, the Bible is the Word of God, that truth is given by God, not made up by you or me, and that wisdom, holiness, sanctification, obedience is demanded by God. It is not optional. We still teach these things, and we hold firm to these things, and we have chapel twice a week to share these things with our students. Well, this past November, I had a student come forward after our chaplain gave a sermon on 1 Corinthians 13. Now, I don't need to remind this audience, because you know what 1 Corinthians 13 stands for, but often when I'm giving a speech like this to a secular audience, I remind them, 1 Corinthians 13 is what? The quintessential love chapter of the Bible. Our chaplain gave a sermon in a required chapel at Oklahoma Wesleyan on 1 Corinthians 13. Pure and simple, no politics, no sarcasm. It wasn't a comedy routine. There was no humor. It was 1 Corinthians 13. It was on love. And a student came up to our chaplain afterwards and said, "You offended me. You offended me and you offended my peers. You singled us out." He played the victimization card. You can't make this up. This kid apparently felt a victim because the chaplain had made him feel guilty for not showing enough love. We've actually taught our kids this nonsense. We've taught them to feel like they're victims anytime somebody offends them and challenges them with a contrary idea. So that if I feel guilty for not being loved because I just heard a sermon on love, I'm the victim, and you're the bigot, you're the oppressor, and you're the victimizer. Well, upon hearing this student's complaint, I had a message for him. And I posted it online for him to read, as well as the rest of our students, our community, and it went viral. Over 3 million people have read it to this day. It was on NBC, it was on Fox and Friends, it was all over the internet. And here's what I said. Young man, that feeling of discomfort you have after listening to a sermon, it's called your conscience.
Yes.
An altar call is supposed to make you feel bad.
Yeah.
It's supposed to make you feel guilty. The goal of many a good sermon is to get you to confess your sins, mm-hmm. not coddle you in your selfishness. The primary objective of the church and the Christian faith is your confession, not your self-actualization. So, young man, let me give you some advice. If you want the chaplain to tell you you are a victim rather than tell you you need virtue, this may not be the right university for
That's
you.
Right. Well.
If you want the chaplain to, if you want to complain about a sermon that makes you feel less than loving for not showing love, this might be the wrong place. If you're more interested in playing the hater card than you are in confessing your own hate, if you want to arrogantly lecture rather than humbly learn, if you don't want to feel guilt in your soul when you're guilty of sin, and if you want to be enabled rather than confronted, there are many universities across the land that will gladly give you exactly what you want, but Oklahoma Wesleyan is not one of them. Oh, I'm not done with him yet. At Oklahoma Wesleyan University, we teach you to be selfless rather than self-centered. We are more interested in you practicing personal forgiveness than political revenge. We want you to model interpersonal reconciliation than foment personal conflict. And we believe in the content of your character more than we do the color of your skin. We don't believe that you've been victimized every time you feel guilty, and we don't issue trigger warnings before altar calls. Oklahoma Wesleyan is not a safe place, but rather a place to learn. To learn that life is not about you, but about others, that bad feeling you have while listening to a sermon is called guilt, and that the way to address it is to repent of everything that's wrong with you, rather than blame others for everything that's wrong with them. This is a place where you will quickly learn that you need to grow up. This is not a daycare, this is a university. Well, like I said, this caused a bit of a grass fire. And before I knew it, Fox and Friends and Glenn Beck and NBC Today and Dr. Drew and Stuart Varney and Bill O'Reilly and Limbaugh and Drudge and Dreher and CBS and CBN, National Review, The Washington Times, The New York Times were all interested. Apparently I said something that many were waiting to hear. Apparently it struck a chord. Many who even openly disagreed with me. In fact, I received many, many hundreds of letters. And here's the poster child for one of them. University of Central Florida Psychology Department letterhead. Gentleman sends me the letter. Letter's probably about that long. Just 3 or 4 sentences. It says, "Dear Dr. Piper, I read you're not a daycare piece, period. I then went to your website and I read a lot of other blogs and writings that you've put out there, period. I'm an atheist. I do not agree with your religion and I do not agree with your politics, period. But on this issue, thank you. Please continue. It needs to be said." Signed, Fulbright Scholar Joe Smith, University of Central Florida. Okay, so here's a question I want to challenge you with today. Why? Why does a simple statement where I'm looking my students in the eye and I'm saying, look, when you hear a sermon on love and it makes you feel bad, you might want to look inward rather than look outward. You might want to confess rather than complain. You might want to talk about your virtue and think about it rather than claim that you're a victim every time somebody challenges you. Why is that newsworthy? Why did anybody care? Well, I believe, and this is the meat of what I want to share with you this afternoon, I believe it's because we as human beings, thoughtful human beings, the Imago Dei, the image of God. I believe it's because we intuitively recognize that we are made in that image, and that there's always great power in ideas. And at the end of the day, every civilization is built not so much by armies and navies, but by speeches and lectures and blogs and books, by the power of ideas, much more than the power of bullets. This is a room of pastors and lay leaders. Your job is to sell ideas. Your job is to sell the word, ideas. Ideas matter. Ideas have great power. They're the most powerful thing that the human being has. That's what distinguishes us, isn't it? From other species. TW and I live in Oklahoma, and when we drive to and from Bartlesville to Tulsa through the ranches, we drive through thousands and thousands of cattle. And the last I knew, those cows aren't out there in the field debating one another. They don't argue with one another. They don't care about ideas. And why is that? They're not the Imago Dei. You are the Imago Dei, not the Imago Dog. And there's a reason for you caring about the power of ideas. I believe that what Richard Weaver told us in 1948 when he wrote his seminal work, Ideas Have Consequences, that ideas have consequences. They always bear fruit. A good idea leads to a good place, good culture, good country, good church, and good kids. And a bad idea leads to the opposite. Bad culture, bad country, bad church, and bad kids. Ideas have consequences. As your grandmother said, garbage in and garbage out. And she was right. Ideas matter. And education today is in crisis. Going to school is no longer known for pursuing truth, but rather for celebrating tolerance. And in the name of tolerance, we are told that our intolerance is intolerable. Education's elites actually parrot this pablum. I can't tolerate your intolerance. I hate you hateful people. I'm sure that nothing is sure, and I absolutely know that nothing can be known. I mean, this is silly. It's self-refuting nonsense. It's like watching your dog chase its tail. You'd get dizzy. You'd get dizzy if it weren't so humorous. The result of this nonsense is that the tradition of good teaching has become the dark flag of tyranny almost overnight. What was academic freedom just yesterday is ideological fascism today. Rather than celebrating liberty, liberals now demand conformity. Campuses are now known as bastions of speech codes rather than bulwarks of free speech. Faculty and students alike are more interested in trigger warnings than they are pursuing truth. Run by the state and its thought police, schools across the land have become indoctrination camps, much more so than campuses of open inquiry. Propaganda and power now reign where there used to be a pursuit of truth. Our track record is terrible. Decade after decade, we've taught our next generation that it doesn't matter what you believe as long as it works for you. That all morality is relative, and that good and evil are merely subjective social constructs. Year after year, pastors and priests have been declared as stupid, and we've told our next generation of leaders that liberation theology is the only good religion. Day in and day out, we've fomented class resentment and racial animus and diminished excellence while extolling entitlement. Why are we surprised at the result? Our leaders have lost their courage, our Congress has lost its conscience, and our kids have lost their character, and our culture has lost its soul. Ideas have consequences. Ideas matter. And lousy ideas that we've been teaching for the past several decades are bearing themselves out before our very eyes. There is an answer. There is an answer to this absurdity, and it's found in the premise that there are certain moral and intellectual laws that are tested by time, defended by reason, validated by experience, and endowed to us by our Creator. I'm going to say that again. The answer is that there are certain ideas. There are certain ideas, moral and intellectual laws that are tested by time, defended by reason, validated by experience, and endowed to us by our Creator. As far back as Moses, and later by Jefferson, we are told that only by trusting in the paradox of liberty and law Can we ever hope to protect our unalienable rights to life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness? And what does happiness mean? It's the opposite of haplessness. The pursuit of happiness is the purpose that is given to us by God as the Imago Dei. It's the opposite of drifting along haplessly with no moral direction and virtue and courage and character. That's the only way to be a free people and a free country and a free church and a free country, is to recognize that those laws that are endowed to us by God are the boundaries that we must live in to enjoy that freedom. Here's an example. G.K. Chesterton once told us, and if you don't know Chesterton, you need to, a turn of the century writer who challenged us. And one of the great challenges of Chesterton was to recognize this. If you get rid of the big laws of God, you don't get liberty, but rather thousands and thousands of little laws that rush in to fill the vacuum. Now listen to that. If you get rid of the big laws of God, you don't get liberty, but rather thousands and thousands of little laws that rush in to fill that vacuum and replace them. God gave us 10 simple laws. He didn't give us reams and reams of laws to live our life within. He gave us 10 simple laws, and Jesus narrowed it down to two.
Right.
10 simple laws, narrowed down to two, that give us the maximum amount of human freedom that we've ever are capable of enjoying. But we despise those laws, abandon those laws, and as the result, the vacuum is filled, and we lose our personal freedom, our religious freedom, our intellectual freedom, we lose our academic freedom, and we become subject to the power games of professors and temper tantrums of students rather than live within those simple laws. There's a reason that dozens of universities were once emblazoned with the motto, "You shall know the truth, and the truth shall set you free." Because it's that context of truth that only gives us that freedom.
Yes.
And if we abandon those laws,
yes,
abandon the truth as the goal and the objective of the academy, you're going to be a people that are enslaved and held in bondage to your own sin or the sin of someone else, rather than living within the beauty and the boundaries of the freedom that God himself gives us.
Amen.
Freedom trusts in principles rather than power or politics. Freedom honors the debate. It knows there's an answer, a true north, a measuring rod outside of those things being measured, which is what C.S. Lewis told us. It may be a little pedantic and even redundant, but I'd like to challenge you today with a very simple message, and here it is. Culture is about ideas, and ideas are defined by words. In other words, words mean something.
Mm-hmm.
Always remember that he who controls the words, he who defines the ideas, wins the debate. Education is about words. Politics is about words. Culture is about words. Words mean something. They have definitions. Words like green and gay and left and right and change and choice and right and wrong and up and down and good and evil and male and female and moral and immoral. All words mean something. And as thinking human beings, as thoughtful moral agents, we do know what the definition of is. And we intuitively know something else, very important. Changing and manipulating the meaning of words is called something. It's called lying. And we also know that deceit always brings consequences. We were told by the prophet Isaiah, "Woe unto him who calls evil good and good evil, darkness light and light darkness, bitter sweet and sweet bitter." Lying about words and with words, turning them upside down, is always wrong. And as self-evident as it should be to all of us, words always mean something and lead somewhere. I want to go back, as I'm getting ready to wrap up here. Let's go back to the example of Bill O'Reilly. Many who stand against what I'm saying right now were challenged with this when I responded to O'Reilly. I said to him, "Many who stand against the fight for religious freedom do so in the name of tolerance. But is their objection really tolerant? When they say they can't tolerate our intolerance, or they hate those hateful people, or they're sure that nothing is sure, and they know nothing can be known, and they're absolutely confident there are no absolutes, Mr. O'Reilly, this makes no sense. They're sawing off the very branch upon which they sit. It doesn't take an eighth grade education to see this for what it is. It's self-refuting, it's nonsense, it's pablum, it's politics at its worst. It's anything but a principled, cogent argument. Any schoolboy can see that the premise posed by these progressives isn't really about tolerance. It never has been. To the contrary, it's really more about tyranny and power.
Yes, yes.
At every turn, we see it on our campuses and in our courts and in our culture. We see angry, red-faced people shouting, "You must agree with us. You must celebrate everything we do. You must believe everything we believe. You must watch and you must applaud." Tolerating anything they find intolerable is of no interest to them. In the end, their worldview is grounded in contradiction more than it's grounded in coexistence. It isn't anything about tolerance or freedom, but rather fascism, pure and simple. Remember what fascism is. Fascism is derived from the word fascist. A fascist was a Roman bundle of sticks bound together so tightly in commonality that it could not be broken. You see it in many of the sculptures, even in the Supreme Court. You'll see the fascist, that commonality of unbroken power. And today's neo-fascism is likewise an unbreakable bundle. It's a group of people bound together so tightly in compliance that there's no dissent, there's no difference, there's no diversity. It's the rule of the gang. It's unquestioned and unchallenged power. It's like the Jacobins of the French Revolution. You must submit. You must agree. Forced agreement is totalitarian. It is not tolerant. Requiring women from the Little Sisters of the Poor, for example, to submit to the whims and wishes of a male-driven government hegemony is not feminism. It's misogyny. This is ideological fascism, as one example. Forcing a Catholic order called the Little Sisters — if you don't know the story, go Google it after I'm done here. The Little Sisters of the Poor are co-petitioners with Oklahoma Wesleyan University in suing the federal government and saying, no, the women that work for our organizations are pro-life by definition. For the Little Sisters of the Poor, they're nuns. They're Catholic. They're celibate. Why do they need any contraception? Stop and think about it. The government is telling a bunch of nuns who are celibate that they must include contraception that induces abortion in their health care. Why? What business is it of the government to tell the pro-life women at the Little Sisters of the Poor or those that work at Oklahoma Wesleyan University what kind of health care they have to have and what drugs they should include therein? I believe the Little Sisters and the Oklahoma Wesleyan women are smart enough to know how to handle their own health care, their own bodies, and their own behavior, and the government should stay out of their business. And a sidebar here, as long as I'm on women. What could possibly be more misogynistic than to ignore the empirically obvious fact of the female and to thereby tell women that they don't even exist biologically anymore, and that if any male, despite bearing all the distinct male physiology, decides that he's a woman, that makes it so? This is absurd. How could I possibly insult you any more than to suggest you don't even exist? And that's what's happening at the federal level right now when it comes to women. I am receiving letters from the Department of Education and the Office of Civil Rights mandating that I start providing transgender bathrooms and locker rooms and showers and dormitories on my Christian college campus under the auspices of Title IX. Now, Title IX was a 1972 law that was established to do what? To give women equal access to the athletic field and to programs. Now, I ask you, government official, how can I possibly give women equal access to anything if you're forcing me to deny the biological fact of the female?
Right.
You're telling me she doesn't even exist any longer, so what rights will she have? Zero. Zero. We need to step forward and say, this is nonsense. I'm pro-woman and I'm proud of it. I digress a bit. Let me get back to my point. Two pages. All right. And I'm going to leave you with this challenge. Here's the key question we face today. And I may make some of you mad, but I can make you mad and go back to Oklahoma. It doesn't matter. Why in the world? I'm very passionate about this next statement. Why in the world would you spend 18 years training up your children in the way they should go so that when they're old, they will not depart from it? And then drive them off to colleges and universities that in the first 18 minutes while you're driving away are going to rip the heart and soul out of your kids. Why would you do that? And I watch you do it day in and day out. Do you realize that 70% of the kids that are churched, walk away from their faith by the time they're a junior in college? Why are you doing this to the next generation within your community? Professors like Richard Rorty, who has been a philosopher on multiple Ivy League institutions and other premier institutions across the land, have proudly said things such as this, and I quote, "Parents, we are going to go right on making your evangelical, Bible-believing ideas seem silly and undesirable in the minds of your students. And you drop them off at these campuses and you drive away." So please, please recognize that ideas matter. Ideas have consequences. Ideas bear fruit. There is no such thing as a neutral idea. Please recognize that words matter, because words define our ideas. We have responsibility. We must take charge of the ideas being taught to our kids, or we are going to lose. We will lose our rights. We will lose our freedom. We will lose our communities. We will lose our country. We will lose our kids, and we will lose our culture. At Oklahoma Wesleyan, I take the four pillars very seriously. What were they? The primacy of Jesus Christ. Jesus is the Son of God. The priority of Scripture. Scripture is the Word of God. The pursuit of truth. Truth is given by God. It is not made up by you or me. And the practice of wisdom. Wisdom and holiness and sanctification. Obedience is demanded by God. It is not optional. Amen. If that's all I give your kids, if that's all I give them, you got your money's worth. You got your money's worth. Now let's talk about one of those pillars as I close. The first one. The first one for a reason. The primacy of Jesus Christ. The Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. The King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, the Lion of Judah, the Lamb of God. Let's talk about the primacy of Jesus Christ. The Word made flesh and dwelling among us, full of grace and truth. The primacy of Jesus Christ, the Word. Why does Jesus describe himself as the Word with a capital W? The way, the truth, and the life. Jesus is truth, and he's the Word. The Word made flesh. The Word incarnate, the Word of God. Education is about words. Now, many of you are here as preachers, and you know this. So here's my challenge. Hang on to your words. That's your business. You can't preach without them. Hang on to your words. Define them and defend them. Honor freedom and fight fascism. Stand for truth and fight tyranny. Stand for love and fight hate. Stand for the rights of women and fight against their subjugation. Stand for liberty and liberation. Fight licentiousness. Remember the words of Dietrich Bonhoeffer. Not to speak is to speak, and not to act is to act. Silence in the face of evil is evil itself. God will not hold us guiltless. I'm going to repeat that. Not to speak is to speak, and not to act is to act. Silence in the face of evil is evil itself. God will not hold you guiltless. Amen. Remember, words mean something. There's a reason that Jesus is described in the Gospel of John as the Word. He means something. He cannot be changed. He is the Logos. He is the way. He is the truth. He is the life. Remember that he is the Word, and remember to defend his words. Remember, you shall know the truth, and the truth shall set you free. Remember, He said, I'm the Alpha and the Omega, the alphabet. Remember that he is the Word made flesh. Remember that he has said in his words, behold, I am coming soon. May the Word be your confidence. May the Word be your courage as you fight the good fight to win the prize for which Christ, the Word, has called us heavenward.
Hallelujah.
Thank you.
Amen.